Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Social Security Committee. Could I remind everyone round the table to turn off their mobile phones, as they do interfere with the recording system. Our agenda item today is the only item on the agenda, an evidence session of the Scottish Government Social Security Bill, the work programme and the transition of devolved benefits more widely to the community. Can I welcome Jean Freeman, Minister for Social Security, to her first, hopefully not her last, appearance at this committee, and also welcome the officials, Anne McVie and Stephen Kerr. I thank the Minister very much for the letter of the August and also September, very, very helpful to the committee. And I know that you want to make a statement, Minister, roughly about 10 minutes or so.
Please. Okay,
hand it over to yourself, Minister. Thank you.
Thank you. To all the members. I'm pleased to be here, and I do hope that we'll find this morning's discussion both interesting and useful. I wanted to take this opportunity as we set out to deliver a brand new social security system for Scotland to talk about some of the things that I believe we need to make sure we get right from the very start. Over the course of this term, our Parliament will take on legislative responsibility for a range of benefits equivalent to 15% of the UK spend on welfare. And that 15% covers benefits currently paid to one in four of us. That's around 1.4 million people in Scotland. It affects a significant number of people's lives. For some of us here today, we're talking about members of our own families, our friends, our neighbours, as well as our constituents. And for each one of us, we do not know when we too might look to social security system for the support we might need. But we must be clear about how complex and challenging a task it will be to build that new system. In 1999, when the Scottish Government became responsible for newly devolved functions of police, education or health, all of them had their own existing Scotland-specific delivery infrastructure. There is no Scotland-specific delivery infrastructure for social security. Current UK disability benefits are administered from locations as widespread as Blackpool, Leeds, Chester and Wembley. The post is routed via Wolverhampton. What we need to deliver a Scottish system, we have to build from scratch. And in building our system, we will still be reliant on the DWP making parallel changes to their IT systems, some of which are decades old. Cold weather payments alone currently rely on a hierarchy of 11 different DWP IT systems, all of which have to be amended to simply identify Scottish customers. The timetable for this work will also partly be driven by the DWP, because we will only be able to switch our services on when the DWP have updated their systems as well. And DWP's own change programmes stretch well into the future. The full service rollout of Universal Credit is not scheduled to complete until 2022. All of this doesn't even get into the operational interdependencies when the two systems are up and running. We have to map out the impacts of our 15% on the remaining 85%. For example, we need to understand the knock-on effects that a change to someone's devolved disability benefit may have on their entitlement to reserved employment support allowance, reserved tax credits, or other reserved passported benefits. Because of all this complexity, it is absolutely critical that we give ourselves time to ensure that any new Scottish Government technology is thoroughly tested and piloted, so that when we start administering benefits, customers receive the right payment in the correct bank account at the right time. So it's our overwhelming, clear priority to ensure that we master this complexity, because we can't take risks with the support we provide to people at what are often crisis points in their lives. Now, Convener, it is entirely possible that we may disagree over some policy decisions that we make as a government as we go forward. But I hope that what I've just said will let this committee join me in my firm belief that we all have a stake in the success of the system we will collectively set up, and in my commitment that policy disagreements notwithstanding, we will none of us use this exercise as some kind of political football. Politicians change, ministers change, even governments change, but this social security system will outlast all of us. The people in this room right now have to make sure that, first of all, the system works for the good of the people of Scotland, second, that it is fit for purpose, and third, that it is properly accountable to ministers and therefore to this Parliament. Our best starting point for all of that, seems to me, is to listen to those currently receiving the benefits we will be responsible for, those who work with and support them, and those who deliver the current system. And that is exactly where we have started with our first step, the current Scotland-wide consultation on social security. This committee in its previous incarnation has done much to show us the importance of doing just that through the successful and highly informative series of Your Say events. Now, we're already over halfway through our consultation exercise. We've been running an extensive programme of face-to-face engagement events from the Borders to the Outer Hebrides. We've got over 100 events in the calendar so far, and we will add more before the consultation closes at the end of October. And the events that the Cabinet Secretary and I have prioritised for attendance have been those where we have been listening precisely to that group of people. We will publish a full report on the responses of the consultation at the start of next year, and by that time, we also hope to have reached an agreement with DWP on the commencement of the remaining two sections of the 2016 Scotland Act, which will pave the way for the introduction of our bill. These commencement discussions are overseen by the Joint Ministerial Working Group on Welfare, which will meet for the second time since this session of our Parliament began, and it will meet on the 11th of October. I'll make sure the committee is updated on the outcome of that meeting. Looking ahead to after the consultation has closed, we will continue to gather evidence through a range of channels, such as our existing policy-specific reference groups and themed events. For example, the National Conference on Funeral Poverty, which we will hold on 16th of November. And we are looking at additional ways in which we can continue to get feedback and involvement from users on a longer-term, ongoing basis. At the same time, we're also progressing stage two of our appraisal of the delivery options for a Scottish social security system by thinking about the way in which our new agency will work in practice as part of a wider system. That means looking at a range of options across the spectrum, from centralisation, where all of the staff and all of the systems and services are based in one place, to localisation, where offices are based around the country and all points in between. Convener, I could sit here and talk for an hour or more and still only skim the surface of what we've got planned over the next few months and of the complexity of the task before us. The main points are in my most recent letter to you and to members, where I've also set out key milestones. But let me take this opportunity to offer you and your members as much access to my officials as you need to answer any questions and give you further information. If it would be helpful for them to meet with you again informally to provide additional briefings on any area of their work, they would, I know, be more than happy to do so. This government intends to hold itself to a gold standard of decision-making on social security, demonstrating at every stage that the decisions we make are made on the basis of the best available evidence, with the direct engagement of those most affected and those with expertise and experience we need, and that we want the involvement of the people of Scotland and the organisations who represent them from start to finish. I believe that this approach will help us steer us through the complex tasks before us and in doing so, ensure that the social security system we establish for Scotland will be an exemplar, the fairest and most accessible social security provision in the UK, where our founding principles of dignity, fairness and respect will be demonstrated in all that we do. And I do believe the people of Scotland deserve nothing less. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Minister. Lots of questions to come from that. Basically, very complex, as you mentioned before. If I could just start off the questions, Minister. Obviously, you mentioned that only 15% of the money is coming to Scotland. And during our evidence session and with constituents also, one of the areas, or two of the areas that come up constantly all the time, is one, people's expectations. People already think we have the powers. So I just wondered how the Scottish Government would manage that. And you highlighted this particular point yourself, the transitional period, which is very important. One in four of Scots obviously are going to be affected by this. The transitional period, how are we going to, or how is the Scottish Government going to handle that without anyone falling through the middle? So I just open it with those two questions, Minister.
Sure. I think the point about expectations is very well made, and obviously in the events and the discussions that we've been having, we're well aware of that. We are in part using those events and the organisations that are facilitating them for us and their networks of communication to try and explain to people exactly what the process is. When the consultation ends, then it is my intention to begin another tour of those organisations to take them through some of the complexity and the steps that we have to take that we are in part discussing this morning, so that there is an understanding about the stages in the process that we have to go through, not because we want to take a long time to do this, but because if we don't go through each of those stages carefully and in the right order, then we absolutely do risk that the system we set up in Scotland, that people fall through the net. And because it is 15%, it has to work in parallel with that 85%, then our system has to work well with the DWP system. And we need to make sure that the interdependencies that will exist because of the nature of the overall benefit system in the UK, where some benefits connect to others and so on, that what we provide, if you like, in Scotland is not taken away because of that interdependency taken away by the DWP. Now that, in truth, requires a huge amount of expertise. So talking to those organisations, everybody from Citizens Advice Bureau right through to the Alliance or Inclusion or the others, is absolutely essential because that's where the expertise lies. Those folks really do understand this stuff and are thinking about things that they need to bring to our attention. So that's in part how we will address the issue of expectation. And I do think, genuinely, that colleagues here in this room can assist us in that by helping locally, where those questions are raised, but elsewhere, helping people to understand the stages we have to go through. And the key point that I made at the outset about, you know, when we began as a Scottish Parliament, when we reconvened, we had Scotland-specific structures for health, for justice, for education. And we took that over, if you like. Here, we're starting from scratch, and we don't have 100%. I make no particular point around that, except that it is easier to do 100% than it is to do 15 alongside 85. Not that I want for a minute to lose the 15. So that's my point, really, on the whole issue of complexity. Your second question, Convener?
About smooth transition?
Yes.
In that respect?
Yes. So we will talk with the Joint Ministerial Working Group on when we introduce when we have the commencement of Tranche 2. That commencement is important because it sits underneath the draft legislation that we will bring to the Parliament before summer next year. That draft legislation is important because it gives us the legislative platform on which to establish the Scottish system. As we go through that work, we are also looking at which of the benefits that are being devolved to us we can introduce earlier, where some of the complexity is not necessarily as difficult as it is in other areas. And we also need, and we will take decisions on that and obviously advise yourselves and the Parliament more widely about those and what we propose to do. But in actually the largest area, which is the area around disability benefits, that's where we're talking about the largest number of people and the greatest complexity. And there may be a period where we will be, where the DWP needs to continue to make the payments before we switch on our system. And in that time, that is when we are testing and learning, particularly on some of the infrastructure, to make sure that when we do switch on, precisely what I said, we have the secure and safe transfer. So people get the money they're entitled to on the day they're entitled to it, at the level that they expect, and they actually neither know nor care which government click the send button to their bank account.
Thank you very much, Minister. I know there's a number of hands up. Ben McPherson. And then
thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Much of the content that I was going to ask about has actually been covered in the Convener's question and your answer, but just to pick up very specifically on, again, on the managing of expectations, you talked about the process and the need to manage expectations through that process and through the development of the new social security system. I wondered as well if there's a determination both from the DWP and stakeholders as well as yourself about how, when we get to the end point, the destination, about making sure that we're managing the expectations of claimants and making sure it's very, very clear to claimants where they access the specific social security benefit that's relevant to their needs. And just a sense of collaboration around the clarity of the system, given the complexity that you spoke of.
Thanks very much. I think the first thing to say is that Scottish Government officials, led by my two colleagues here, and DWP officials have been working very hard on all of this for some time, predates me, and have worked very well and continue to work very well to understand what each needs to do and exchange information and so on. And equally, the Joint Ministerial Working Group is really clear about the importance of the task and finding solutions to some of the issues that come up. That's the first thing to say. The second thing I think to say is that actually I think the point you, or the question you raised, touch on an important area of work that we also need to undertake and have begun, and that is around the whole question of what advice and support is available to individuals about how to access the system, what they're entitled to, how to make their claim, and what to expect thereafter. And it is my intention that when people come to the Social Security System for Scotland, they will be given that information about all benefits, not simply those that are the responsibility of the Scottish Government. So we have begun an exercise across the whole of Scottish Government that is mapping out where advice services currently exist, who provides them, how are they funded, and what is it they actually provide advice on, so that we can look at that and see how fit is that for the purpose that we have here for Social Security, and what might we do to ensure that we have a more comprehensive system of advice and support across the country that is accessible to you no matter where you live. So there's also the question then about different ways of accessing advice and support. So that is a parallel piece of work, but very critical to all of this. There's no point in having a all singing, all dancing system in Scotland if nobody knows how to get near it, how to access it, or what to expect from it. But the key point for me is that we do that exercise, but the advice and support that people are given is about the entire benefit system, regardless of who is responsible for it.
Okay. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. Adam Tompkins.
Good morning, Minister, and thank you for coming to speak with us, and thank you for your opening statement, which I very much welcome, particularly the remarks about political footballs. And in that spirit, can I ask you about something which is, I think, an animating theme, both of your letter to the convener and of your opening statement, which is the importance of close and effective working relations between the Scottish Government and the United Kingdom Government. In your letter, you say that we must work with our UK counterparts and their programmes of work, because this is the only way to ensure the safe and secure transition of these powers. Now, in the notes that Spice gave the committee in preparation for this meeting, I don't know if those notes have been shared with you, Minister, there's a report from an interview with the Cabinet Secretary, reported in the Daily Record in September, where Angela Constance says, and I quote, "We're not going to be giving them," that's to say the UK government, "any information or responding to inquiries if we think that that might lead to a sanction." If that is an accurate quote, and I admit it's only from the Daily Record, but it is in the Spice notes, how is that contributing to an effective and cooperative working relationship with the UK government?
Well, you see, Mr. Tomkins, that is the big challenge, right? Because the big challenge is that the Scottish government and the UK government start from different political standpoints. And those disagreements are not going to go away. And we shouldn't pretend that they're going to go away, which is why I also made the point that, you know, in this committee, with different members of this committee in the chamber, we are going to have policy disagreements. That is not the same, though, as saying that we will have some kind of political grandstanding or shouting match around this. And that's the bit I want to avoid. We'd be daft to try and pretend amongst ourselves, far less to the wider population, that we don't disagree. Of course we disagree on some things. So, we have made very clear as a Scottish government, and we had the agreement of Ian Duncan Smith when he was in the relevant post, that the devolved work programmes to Scotland would be entirely for the Scottish government to decide whether they were voluntary or not. And I think on the 13th of September, my counterpart, Mr. Hepburn, wrote to Damien Green seeking clarification that that remained the UK government's position. Now, we expect it to remain the UK government's position, in which case there is no information on whether or not an individual attends that work programme run by the Scottish government to pass on to anybody. What the Cabinet Secretary said was, should it be the case that the UK government changes its position from that assurance given to us by Mr. Duncan Smith in terms of the voluntary nature of our programmes, then we would have to take a view as to whether or not we would pass any information back to the DWP with respect to a person's participation, where we think that information could lead to that individual being sanctioned, because as a Scottish government, we have taken a very clear and consistent view that we do not believe that sanctions are either fair or effective in their intended overall purpose, as outlined to us by the UK government, of incentivising people to enter the workplace. Simply don't think it works. So that's our political and policy position. UK government have their political and policy position. We need to find ways of recognising both of those, but finding ways of working together.
I know that Alison, do you want to come in on that particular point?
Yeah, it was just to point out, as the Minister has, that in our papers there is a letter from Jamie Hepburn in which he points out that Ian Duncan Smith, the then Secretary of Work and Pensions, wrote to Rosanna Cunningham, the then Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work, Skills and Training, to advise that the extent of conditionality on devolved employment programmes would be a matter for this government. So I don't think, I think it would be less cordial to go back on that agreement that we clearly have. That was all. I just wanted to point out that the information is in the pack we have for today.
Yeah, thank you very much, Alison. Mark, was it on that specific point?
Cause specifically on sanctions.
Mark Griffin, yeah.
Thanks, Kavina. It was just to ask if there had been any consideration in terms of the fiscal framework. I think it's a welcome policy decision by the government to not take the same sanctions-driven approach. But if the Scottish government's approach is successful and the claimant count is reduced and the bill if it was just, is that something that's been taken into consideration with the discussions around the fiscal framework? And would that then lead to an increase in the government budget? Or similarly, if any programme the government undertook wasn't as successful, would that result in any clawback from the UK government?
There are some technical provisions in the fiscal framework that are designed to look at the very circumstances that you outline, but the bar in those is set quite high in terms of whether the impacts are direct or indirect. So there may be occasions where the governments want to have a conversation about action that one takes, the impacts on action or behaviour of clients or policies that the other government pursues. But I think being able to sit here just now and say this circumstance will definitely have this impact, which will have this financial result, is very difficult to do. But there's certainly provisions in the framework that will allow either government to begin a conversation on that. But those conversations have to be ones where together the governments agree that there is an impact and an effect.
Okay. Thank you. Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. Good morning, Minister. Just firstly, to endorse what you've said about the work that's required here to create a new agency, that can, on day one of its operation, can be a smooth transition. So it's hard work, I think, that's required, and not politics. Although, having said that, I do wholeheartedly agree with the government's approach to where you have responsibility in relation to sanctions and conditionality. Perhaps we can discuss another, if there's time at the end, about what other scope there would be in further to the employability schemes, where the government could take the same view on whether it can draw back from the UK government's position on conditionality. But I wanted to really just discuss a broader question, which is how do we create this agency in day one that is, as you see, the switch over, just to simplify it? It will obviously not be as simple as that. So is it possible then, or do you see it, if you want to paint a picture of how this is going to work, would there almost be like a shadow arrangement, a shadow agency pre the switchover? It seems to me that's the only way that you could ensure a smooth transition. Or you're not in a position to make any arrangements until the legislation is in place?
Certainly the legislation is absolutely key, because it gives us, if you like, the legal platform on which to move forward. So the legislation is a really important step in the move to the Scottish agency. I'll let either of my colleagues supplement what I might say, but I think the two things. First of all, part of what we do in terms of the operational delivery is a section of the consultation. So it's important to me that we wait to hear what people are saying to us in terms of the shape they want this agency to take, how they want it to deliver its services, and where they want it to be in terms of central, local, or and so on. It's also very important to me that in the follow-on work that we do, where we are going to use the experience and expertise of people who are currently on the receiving end of the current system, that we're also using the experience and expertise of people who are currently delivering the existing system, to help us design the right processes and procedures to ensure that some of the things we want to achieve, which is about speed of decision making, transparency, key issues, key questions around evidence for the disability benefits, where that information comes from, the nature of assessments, and so on, that they're all involved in helping us to design that. Now, as we make progress, the possibility of shadow arrangements or transition arrangements are in the mix, but I don't think at this stage that we are sufficiently far advanced to have reached a final view on any of those particular options. And the other part of work that is going on is, of course, the stage two option appraisal on the nature of the agency that we will establish. So at this point, I think a fair thing to say, although I'll ask Stephen or Anne to supplement what I'm saying, is that it is not possible at this point, and indeed wouldn't be right for us at this point, to have taken a firm view on whether you make the transition in a staged way or whether you simply do all your testing and then flick the switch.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's absolutely right. There is some preparatory work you can do. So you can go and visit DWP sites. You can, as we've done, been to the Isle of Man, Ireland, Northern Ireland, and see how other jurisdictions administer benefit payments and how their operations are organised. So that, if you like, is the learning phase that we're going through. There are also certain things that an agency will have with the Scottish Government, however it's composed. So it will have something called a framework document that sets out the relationship between ministers and the agency, and you can start to think about the shape of these sorts of things. But as the minister says, these are sort of early and preparatory things one can do. However, until the consultations close, the options appraisal work is done, the work really begins thereafter.
Could I just press a wee bit further? So yeah, that makes sense. But should, at the end of that consultation, you be of the view or have a particular view that in order to deal with the complexity and the new design, that you would have to almost set up a shadow operation or whatever? I suppose I'm just really wondering what steps you can take before the legislation, or do you have to wait till the legislation's passed and then work on the basis of the what scope do you have, in other words, to sort of set something up to ensure that smooth transition?
Yeah, I think the key answer I want to give you is that a number of bits of work run in parallel. So the legislation will come, the draft legislation will be presented to Parliament before summer next year, and will go through due process. But that doesn't mean that that everything stops while we do that. And we all just focus on that. You know, one of the figures that Stephen gave me this morning, so I've talked a bit about complexity. In terms of scale, that the number of payments that this new agency, when it is fully functional, will make per week is equal to the number of payments that the Scottish Government currently makes per year. So the scale is huge and the complexity is complex. So to do that without taking a very, very long time, partly in response to your point, convener, about expectations and Mr. McPherson's too, and also partly because, frankly, we want these responsibilities. I'm absolutely confident and convinced that we will run a better system. So I want to get going and doing it because I think it will make a big difference to the 1.4 million people whose lives in part we will be responsible for helping to make better. So in order to do all of that, you have to run a whole number of parallel bits of work and try and, as you do that, so legislation's part of it, but so are all these other areas, and try as you do that to work out how and when they are going to connect up with each other. And one of the parallel bits of work, of course, is with the DWP, but it's also around the shape and nature of the agency, the options we might have about transitioning into taking that responsibility, which benefits can we take over sooner rather than later, and really importantly, what do we need to do to establish the right culture inside the Social Security Agency for Scotland that itself delivers dignity, fairness and respect to those who work in it, in order that we can reasonably expect them to deliver that to those who come to its door. Now, that whole cultural question is a big challenge, but I'm sure we can manage it. But all of that means, that scale and that complexity means that we are currently running and will continue to run a number of parallel bits of work, each one of which is critical to the other.
Thank you. Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Convener. In your introduction this morning, Minister, you reiterated that only 15% of the benefits budget would be devolved, but obviously that's only 15% if we don't use top-up and top-up powers or create new benefits. So we do have the ability to do that, but I think it is fair to say that top-up powers aren't really focused on in any great detail at all in the consultation, and I wondered why that might be the case.
Well, the 15% that will be devolved will be 15%. That doesn't change. We're not getting anything more in terms of what the UK is currently responsible for. We do also, though, quite rightly, as you say, have the power to create new benefits or to top up existing benefits. It does feature in the consultation, and already in some of the discussions I've had, people have raised that. But actually, the primary issues that are coming through the consultation are about how people feel they are treated, perceived areas of unfairness and difficulty, and accessibility, and so on. So it's not in our mind. It is part of our consideration and discussion. But we do also have to remember that over a significant period, and I'll give you the exact period in a minute, but the overall Scottish budget has been cut by a considerable amount, 10%, just over 10.6%, if I recall that correctly. So there are a number of difficult decisions to make across Scottish Government, into which goes this and this entire new system. And we will, as I said, look carefully at the decisions we make based on the best evidence available that meet our overall objectives as a Scottish Government, one of which is, of course, particularly targeted on reducing poverty.
I appreciate that the budget has been impacted by cuts from Westminster, but also that we now have the ability to mitigate some of those cuts with taxation powers that we will have. I think dignity and respect, I agree entirely there's a need to change the culture, but I think dignity and respect too are achieved by adequacy, having enough income to have a decent standard of living. And you'll be aware that the Child Poverty Action Group are calling for a £5 top-up of child benefit, for example. And I'd just like your views on what opportunities you think the new system presents for tackling child poverty in particular.
Well, of course, we have a child poverty bill that will come to Parliament, and that will specifically focus on that. I'm very well aware of the Child Poverty Action Group's proposal. I've had discussions with them, as indeed has the Cabinet Secretary. The point I'd make about mitigation is, of course, that this government has a significant track record of using considerable sums of money to mitigate against the worst effects of the UK government's policy decisions on welfare support, particularly in our full mitigation of the bedroom tax. And we have made an absolute commitment that when we have the powers, we will abolish the bedroom tax, but also in other ways through the Scottish Welfare Fund and in other measures we've taken. The difficulty with mitigation is that what you are doing is you are spending money to stand still. Now, I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't do any of those things. They have been the right and proper things to do. But it does mean that Scottish Government resources are going into the pot in order for us to stand still and not make progress. On the question of the Child Poverty Action Group's proposal, we are giving that consideration. There is additional evidence, though, for example, Joseph Rowntree Foundation, very well respected in terms of its research and evidence in this regard, would argue that any increase in child benefit should be focused on low and middle income families. So we need to look at the overall impact of any additional top-ups or new benefits that we might introduce in terms of what evidence exists to demonstrate that that would make a significant impact on our overall objective of reducing poverty. And we will do that work and in due course be coming back, probably through the child poverty discussion, but perhaps also in this one too, to look at the policy positions that we want to propose as a government in regard to all of those areas.
Alison, certainly we look forward to the child poverty bill coming through the committee, and we'll certainly look into that as well. Ruth, I think you wanted to come in on that one, and then Adam, did you want to come in?
It's a new question. Is that
Sure.
Yeah. Thank you, convener. Thanks, Minister. I really welcome your statement that advice given from the Scottish Social Security Agency will cover all benefits, and it's kind of on that line that I want to explore. We've heard evidence, and just I know in our own sort of knowledge from our dealings with constituents that passported benefits can minimise the strain and the worry that goes along with needing help from Social Security. I just wondered what your thinking was along about the scope of providing passported benefits, both within our own system and between the Scottish and the UK system.
Passported benefits is one of the areas that we have to be very careful about in terms of the interaction of the Scottish system with the UK system, in order to make sure that anything we do with the benefits that we're responsible for doesn't have a negative impact on the passported benefits that would otherwise have existed that come from the DWP. So that is one of the many areas that are subject to quite detailed discussion and will continue to be with colleagues in DWP, and will be raised to the ministerial group if there are issues that need to be resolved at that level. We do have existing passported benefits, if you like, that sit with us. So, for example, when we take over winter fuel payments, then although pensions are at UK level, that also brings in free bus travel. In terms of looking at the whole issue around young carers, we are looking there at the package of support that might be offered, which could include some of those passported benefits. So we're very alive to that, and I do absolutely understand, not only as a constituency MSP, but in this role, the difference that can make to people's lives and to not only their financial position, but their capacity to be included in a number of other community or social areas that the rest of us just take for granted. So I'm absolutely alive to the importance of that, and it's in the mix of everything else that we're looking at.
Thank you.
Want to come back in? George Adam.
Good morning, Minister. I would like to ask questions about those that are living in poverty, because last week Bill Scott of Inclusion Scotland, and I'll reread it from the official record, brought up about the fact that 48% of those living in poverty are either disabled people or people living with disabled people. A further 40% of disabled children live in poverty, and 44% of children of disabled adults live in poverty. Does that quote alone not just highlight the scale, the level of the challenge that the Scottish Government has when we're actually dealing with this new system?
Yes, it absolutely does. And of course, the additional statistic that you could add into that is the disproportionate impact that poverty has and how it affects women. So we've got some very difficult challenges here. I do think, though, that there are key steps that we can take. Some of those we've made in our commitments already, in terms of extending how we deal with disabled children and the support that's given to them, including around fuel support. But also in the work that we're doing with those organisations, including Inclusion, to help us design a system that gives people greater access to the benefits that they're entitled to and encourages more individuals to take up the benefits that they're entitled to. We still have a case, a situation where there are numbers of people who are entitled to support who aren't seeking that support, perhaps because they don't know about it. There are interconnections in terms of the disability support that we can provide and our overall objective about reducing the numbers of people who are disabled, who are unemployed, and in the support that we can provide around carers allowance and attendance allowance. And some of the interdependencies that currently exist there can work against people quite seriously. And we need to have a look at, for example, the eligibility criteria around carers allowance that can allow people to, that should allow, in my opinion, people to undertake the caring responsibilities that they want to undertake, but also doesn't close them off from employment or education opportunities. So there are a range of steps that we can take that will begin to address those issues, but of course they are themselves limited by the fact that it's not 100%. And we have to recognise that. I'm not whining about it, but it is a straightforward fact. It's not 100%, so there are limitations on how far we can go in some of this.
One of the other things as well is obviously we're living in a time, and this is again comes down to the situation where the Scottish Government and the Westminster Government have two politically opposing opinions, is the fact that with disabled people at the moment, the PIP reassessments, it's one of the major issues that people are going through. About 80% are actually getting it in appeal, you know, and the whole process. And one of the other things that Bill Scott brought up as well was that for the old DLA, 70% of assessments were carried out in paper, not face-to-face. For personal independence payment, 95% of assessments are face-to-face, which costs 3.5 times as much as the old assessment system. We're paying for assessments with money that could go towards supporting disabled people. Is this not another example of, if we're talking about dignity and respect, you know, there is a better way. We can actually find a better way to work it, and the current system is extremely flawed when it comes to dealing with disabled families.
I absolutely agree. One of the most striking things in the consultation events I've attended so far and the conversations I've had so far is how the current system strips people of their dignity and undermines their self-esteem and is perceived by them to be deeply unfair. Deeply unfair. Now, I think that, you know, we go back to the starting point about what is the purpose of those particular disability benefits. The purpose of the benefits is to provide people with support for the additional costs they have to meet because of their disability or their health condition. It's not a judgment on whether or not they are disabled. Now, many folks that I have spoken to have told me that their perception is and this is without fail, and it is across the country, that their perception is that they are treated on the, as if they are trying to cheat the system. Our premise, so we have those guiding principles of dignity, fairness and respect. We have another really important premise that has to run right through everything we do. And that is that the people who will come to the social security system for Scotland will do so because they need to. And therefore, our job is to help them provide for what they need as best as we can within all the overall limits that we would know about. So if we take the current PIP approach, it seems to me that if you remember what the purpose of the benefit is, then your starting point should be what evidence do you actually need in order to understand the condition that the individual has and what additional costs that might bring. Where would you get that information? You would get it from medical records or from social care information. It already exists. So we are in discussions with colleagues about how that information can be provided at the entry point in order, and not with an additional burden on the individual claimant, at the entry point in order to help us meet two key objectives. One is that we do want to be able to have lifetime awards and long-term awards. And by long-term awards, I mean genuine long-term awards, not a five-year award where you get called for a reassessment sometime in year two and everything's thrown up into the air again. But also where we can actually then only have face-to-face assessments where that is really needed. So it may be that the individual triggers that themselves because their condition has worsened and they require to pay for additional support. But we also know that the current system doesn't seem able to deal with conditions of mental ill health or fluctuating conditions, where individuals can be more mobile one day than they are the following day, where individuals will make considerable effort to be as independent as they can be, but the physical toll can mean that for the next 2 or 3 days, they will be confined to bed. We need to understand, the system needs to understand those conditions and be able to deal with them in a way that allows the individual to retain their dignity and feel respected. I'm absolutely confident we can do that. And we can do it in a way that minimises the amount of resource that goes into running the system in order to maximise the amount of resource that you've got for the individuals in the system. You know, any system that has an upholding of appeal rate that the current one does, that I understand is around 65%, is a system that's not working. And if that was the case in any other area of activity, then we'd be jumping up and down and saying, your system's rubbish and you need to fix it. So my position is we need to fix that from the outset. We will, of course, have an appeal process, but I absolutely do not expect it to produce that kind of result because I want us to get it right from the very beginning.
Just one final question. Basically, it was a lot of the groups, disabled groups that were in the roundtables, were quite impressive about how a very realistic approach they were taking to this was the fact that they knew it was difficult. They wanted it as quickly as possible, but they were under the impression that they knew the government had to get it right. And they actually even went as far as saying they didn't expect us to get it 100% right because that's just human endeavour, that just can't happen. But they actually wanted to make sure they could get it as possibly close to perfect as we can get it. Now, that was great, but is that not an example of the Scottish Government currently working in co-production almost with these groups, and is that going to continue over the next while we get the bill through as well?
I think you're right that the groups that represent and work with disabled people are very realistic about the scale and the complexity of that. We need to make sure that understanding and that knowledge is as widespread as possible. To take up the convener's first question, because I think that is absolutely critical. The co-production will absolutely continue. I personally am absolutely convinced that the best way you design anything is to involve the people currently on the receiving end of it and currently delivering it. I know that from my experience in health, that you get better health pathways when you do that, you get smarter systems, and you get greater patient satisfaction when that is how you work in health. So there is absolutely no reason to doubt that taking that approach into this, where we've got the chance to build it from scratch, we've got that blank sheet of paper, albeit we can only write in 15% of it, but it's there. When you do that, then you absolutely have to involve those folk. So it's finding ways to do that. Consultation exercise is the start, but right through this, and actually past the introduction of the system for Scotland, I want us to continue to involve those who are receiving benefits and entering that system, as well as those who will be working in it, to continue to evaluate for us how well it is working. There is no reason to stop just because you've set it up and to then assume, because I'm grateful to those organisations for not thinking that we will necessarily be 100% perfect. And in light of that, then we need them to continue to evaluate how well we're doing so that we can continuously improve what we're doing.
Gordon Linders.
Yes, thank you, Minister, for coming in today. You mentioned the bedroom tax, and I don't want to ask you about that because, as you rightly say, there's policy issues there. But to put my question in context, speaking about people who own their own homes, who then have to go into care, and there's provisions about requirements to provide from their assets for funding. And again, that's possibly a policy issue. What I'm more interested in and wanted to ask you about is looking to your programme and the ideas of dignity and respect. Is the situation of vulnerable elderly and disabled people who fall into that category where they may have to provide out of their own assets to pay for their own care, is that being specifically looked at to ensure that a transition from circumstances is made as easy as possible for them in terms of the systemic way of looking at things and how the systems are being set up?
Well, it certainly seems to me that the core of your question relates to our overall policy on the provision of health and social care, which lies with my colleagues in health. But it is absolutely the case that in the work that we're doing on the social security system for Scotland, there are clear interconnections across government with other portfolios in health, in employment, in the economy. And I can offer you the assurance that now we are having those discussions between ministers and officials in government, and will continue to do so as we work our way through the work that we've got in front of us. And I'm sure that colleagues in health are mindful of the point that you're raising.
Thank you, Mr. Gard. Yep, Mark Griffin.
Minister, in your opening remarks, you talked about when the system starts and the first payment is made, that payment is made to the right person, the right account. And it was just to delve a little deeper into the government's thinking of who that right person is. We've had the evidence from Engender and other organisations who've mentioned, who've given examples about women who are in abusive relationships where benefit payments are made directly to the abusive partner, and that limits their independence and their ability to escape those situations. Can I ask if the government are making, what your thoughts are on whether you would make paying the woman in the household the default person to receive benefits?
Thank you for that. I have heard and understand very well similar points made to me and to Cabinet Secretary from Engender and from other organisations about the issues around the single householder payment of universal credit. Now, as I'm sure you know, part of what will be devolved to us are what are termed flexibilities around universal credit. So we won't have responsibility for universal credit, but we will have flexibilities that will allow us to consider, for example, increasing the frequency of payment, where at the moment it is monthly, looking at making that a fortnightly payment, offering the individual the choice for the rent component of universal credit to be paid direct to their social landlord, and also now this question about the single householder payment. We are looking at all of those, including that last one. There are different ways, and we're talking with Engender and other organisations about how might you achieve that, what mechanism could we use to do it? Is it the principal carer of children, or are there other mechanisms that might be possible to make that happen? So we're very mindful of it and absolutely looking at it. The additional issue, though, that we have with universal credit is that in order to be able to exercise those flexibilities, ideally, we would be required to wait. Ideally is the wrong word. We are told that we would be required to wait until universal credit is fully rolled out. Now, despite the fact that it was announced in 2010, the final rollout of it now is not expected until 2022. That is some considerable time away, and the issue is around the capacity inside DWP to roll out universal credit and also introduce the measures they need to take to allow us to exercise those flexibilities. So we are currently looking at ways in which we might work with them to be able to introduce the flexibilities earlier than waiting till the final rollout of universal credit. That takes you into the whole field of IT systems, of data gathering and sharing, of identifying the right people in the right place, precisely your point, at the same time as DWP are undergoing a major change program in the introduction of universal credit. So we've not concluded those discussions by any means. The best assurance I can offer you is twofold. One, we're very well aware of the additional point you make with respect to the issues raised by Engender and other women's organisations, and actually by others in inclusion and elsewhere, where we are talking with the parent of a young adult with learning disabilities, for example, who may be independently living to an extent as well. There are issues around that. So we're very mindful of all of those, but equally mindful that the current rollout of universal credit is not expected to complete until 2022. So we're also beginning to think about and have discussions about are there other options that would allow us to introduce the flexibilities, whatever policy decision we take on those, earlier than waiting till after 2022. I don't know if Stephen wants to add a bit.
I was just to point out that at the Joint Ministerial Working Group next month, this is an area that ministers will be discussing.
And I think, Minister, you mentioned the fact that you would keep us updated in anything, because that's a very important point. If we're getting the rollout a bit later, it would be ideal if we could come in there and have our say, basically, and hopefully get that rolled out a bit earlier.
Absolutely.
In that respect. I think, Adam Tompkins, do you want to come in?
Thank you, Convener. Minister, you mentioned a little while ago now in an earlier remark the work of the Joseph Rantry Foundation. And you will have seen, I'm sure, the recent lengthy publication by Joseph Rantry about a comprehensive strategy of solving poverty across the whole of the UK, including in Scotland. And one of the things that, I think it's a very challenging document, I think it's challenging for all of us, but one of the things that they say in that document is that for those who can, work represents the best route out of poverty. So my first question is whether you agree with that. And the second question is that very strikingly, the Joseph Rantry Foundation also say in this document that additional spending on benefits without addressing the root causes of poverty has failed to reduce poverty. Has failed to reduce poverty. That's a very strong statement. And I wondered if you also agreed with that statement. And if you did, what, in addition to social security spending, you think the Scottish Government's principal priorities are for tackling poverty in Scotland?
Thank you very much. I think we'll also find, and this I would agree with, that Joseph Rowntree are very clear that it is not work per se that is a route out of poverty, but well-rewarded work that is a route out of poverty. We know, and you do too, Mr. Tompkins, the significant numbers of people in work who are also in poverty because of low hourly payments, short-term contracts, zero-hour contracts, and so on. So work per se, in and of itself, is not necessarily the route out of poverty, but well-rewarded and recognised work is certainly a major contributor towards families and individuals not being in poverty. And indeed, that's exactly what families and individuals themselves want. So I would caveat that statement that you made at the outset, and I do believe that Joseph Rowntree would agree with me. In terms of benefits, an increase in benefits, I think that one of the things that the Joseph Rowntree publication says very clearly and is very helpful is about the package of measures that any government should, and indeed they talk about national, Scottish, and local government. So a whole tier of government across the UK, that it is a package of measures that are properly focused and work in concert that they believe can seriously make a big difference, a huge difference, towards, as they describe it, ending poverty in the UK. What they are talking about there is getting to a point where there is no destitution, where poverty is short-term, and people may move into poverty, but the opportunities are there for them to move out of it, and there is no long-term systemic poverty. So again, it is important to understand exactly what it is they're saying. And so, you know, there is no single thing. Now, you know, social security in and of itself is not going to, no matter what kind of system we set up, in and of itself, sitting alone is not going to be the silver bullet to end poverty in Scotland. But it can be a major contributor towards that goal, or it can contribute to poverty. And I would argue that some of the steps that have been taken at a UK level have significantly impacted on individuals' capacity to get out of poverty or not. And in some instances where, for example, the assessment in the transfer over from DLA to PIP removes a mobility component for that individual, which may remove their capacity to remain in work, that is not assisting that individual moving out of poverty. So in and of itself, there isn't a single thing that can end poverty. If there was, we would have found it, and between us all, we would have done it. But it is the package of measures, it is the combination of UK, Scottish and local government working together towards that goal. And it is ensuring that where you've got components like social security, that you do your best with that system to contribute to helping individuals move out of poverty, and you absolutely do not negatively impact on their capacity to leave poverty. And in fact, in some instances, bump them back into it.
Just a very brief follow-up.
Well, I was just going to ask the Minister, I think she's here for an hour. I mean, basically, it's now 20 minutes to 11. Would that be the last question, or could you take another question?
I'll take another question.
Okay, then. So it's a long question,
no, it's
Mr.
Very
Donkin,
short question.
I know somebody else wants to come in.
And the Minister's been very generous with her time, thank you. But the just as a very brief follow-up to that, I mean, one of the concerns, I suppose, you know, we all have, in government and opposition, is the joined up nature of effective anti-poverty strategies. And in your answer to Mr. Lyndhurst's question, you talked about the relationship between your officials and health. What can you say to reassure us that the joined upness between social security and employability in particular is there in the current structure of the Scottish Government?
I can give you that assurance. I can give you that assurance. I mean, Stephen or Anne will respond in terms of joint official working. But certainly Mr. Hepburn and I have had a number of conversations to make sure that the work that he is progressing in terms of devolved employment programmes and the work that I'm progressing in terms of the social security system for Scotland, that we're both aware of what we're doing and that we are looking at where we can come together and do some joint work, and also where the direction of travel that he's taking and the one that I'm taking complement each other and aren't producing additional contradictions. You know, absolutely the last thing I want to have is enough complexity in this whole thing without adding to it. But in addition, the other point I can make, which I hope provides assurance, is, of course, just as an aside, I've already talked about how we are discussing with health colleagues on some of these matters as well. So it's not simply in terms of employment. But I can say that, of course, This work that I undertake sits in within the overall portfolio of Ms. Constance, which includes poverty. And we are very clear with colleagues across government that it is not this portfolio that will fix poverty. It is our job to lead and to provide strategic direction and to take action, but that is an exercise that is across government. And the work is going on at this point to look across government at how other portfolios can contribute and how we can take the best lessons that we need to learn from that piece of Joseph Rowntree work and others in order to make sure that we're as joined up and moving in the direction as we possibly can.
Well, thank you.
It was just to add a couple of comments from my perspective. The Minister's told quite a compelling story of co-production and working with external stakeholders. It's my job to get the internal workings across government set in the right direction. There is no way we can deliver any of this programme in splendid isolation. So, you know, in terms of the programme of work we're putting in place, people in health will be involved, people in employability will be involved in the work that we do, and likewise, we will cross-populate each other's programme boards. They sit up the stairs from me in Glasgow. We talk to them often. The director of employability and I are sitting down, I think, in a couple of weeks' time just to talk about those connections, make sure the relationships are right for the joint work that we're taking forward. And DWP are quite helpful in this regard as well, because the people in DWP span both employability and social security. So if we ever forget the internal connectedness, they're a good reminder that actually that's something that we just have to do as part of our DNA.
Yeah, certainly. I thought the meeting we had the way day with the DWP was excellent, and I think we all got something out of that particular one. Minister, can you take one small question from the Vice Convener?
Of course I can.
Pauline.
Thanks. Hopefully it'll be short. I just wanted to ask you to clarify. So the briefing we have said both governments have agreed that the UK government will provide a one-off transfer of £200 million to the Scottish government to support the implementation of the new powers. And both governments have also agreed a baseline transfer of £66 million to cover the ongoing administration costs. It was just to clarify, that figure of 200, is that, if you like, a purse? Is that the money for distribution for benefits, or is that admin costs? I know the £66 million is the admin costs. Presumably, has been ongoing discussion then about further transfer of money to support the benefits paid out?
Yeah. The 200 million is implementation costs.
So the both figures are implementation costs?
Well,
all right.
The 66 is a recurring amount that we will receive each and every year, so it will fall into the Barnet share that the Scottish Government gets from the UK Government. The 200 million is a one-off payment that we will take from the UK Government as a contribution towards the costs for all the powers in the Scotland Act, not just Social Security.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister. It's certainly been very interesting. A lot of good questions and answers as well. And I'm sure we'll have you back at the committee again. Look forward to it. I'm sure you'll look forward to it too. And I close the meeting at this moment. Thank you very much. Thank you.